Biomass can be an excellent alternate fuel supply. And if you own a lot of marginal land, you should give biomass some consideration, especially if you don't have access to natural gas. You can burn wood chips from lumber mills to heat buildings, but you can also grow your own biomass for a consistent, sustainable supply.
There are two basic types of biomass: woody, such as willow trees, and herbaceous, like Miscanthus, a perennial grass. Some greenhouse owners are heating their greenhouses with biomass. And in rural areas, farmers are burning biomass to heat their barns, buildings, and homes. And stoves that burn biomass pellets are already popular with everyday consumers. There could be money to be made growing biomass crops. Mahendra Thimanagari is a crop bioproduct specialist with the Ontario Ministry of Agriculture and Food. He's working with a group to explore the feasibility of commercializing agricultural biomass for combustion energy.
Since 2010, Ontario Minister of Agriculture and Food and Minister of Rural Affairs and Ontario Power Generation have co-led a project to commercialize agricultural biomass for combustion energy. The team includes researchers, industry experts, innovators, a steering committee, and three working groups. Their goal is to build an understanding of the agronomic, technical, environmental, and economic potential of agricultural biomass for combustion.
Biomass can also be used to make a variety of bioproducts, such as bioplastic that could replace petroleum-based plastic, a liquid fuel that could be used to make ethanol, and willow bark has medicinal properties similar to aspirin. There's already a market for animal bedding made from biomass.
And with markets emerging, such as bioproducts, we recognize the need to look at the whole range of opportunities for agriculture biomass beyond combustion.
Biomass just received a boost from the Ontario Power Authority. It has increased its feed-in tariff price for buying power from renewable energy sources.
For biomass, the price increased from 13.8 cents per kilowatt hour to 15.6 cents per kilowatt hour, so which is about 13% increase.
There's another good reason to consider growing your own biomass. Once established, it's pretty easy to grow, even on marginal land.
That may pique your interest, but you might ask, which type of biomass will give me the best yield, woody or herbaceous? It's a challenge that agroforestry researchers have taken to heart.
The problem you have in Ontario and in a lot of other areas is that, you know, people say, you know, Miscanthus or willow will yield so much, and it will yield more or less than another species. But until you have them in side-by-side trials, you really can't make those claims and substantiate them.
Dr. Andrew Gordon heads up the Agroforestry Research and Development Group in the School of Environmental Sciences at the University of Guelph.
Basically, to compare how these different species grow, we're growing both herbaceous and woody crops at the same time on marginal land, basically to evaluate which one is going to be the better biofuel. The graduate student that led the research was John Mann.
Here we researched poplar, switchgrass, miscanthus, willow, and a polyculture blend of grasses, which was switchgrass, Indian grass, big blue stem, and little blue stem. And the polyculture, poplar, and switchgrass were planted in 2009, whereas the miscanthus and the willow were planted in 2010 due to crop failures in 2009.
That first year didn't go so well. Only 40% of the willow and 10% of the miscanthus survived the winter.
This was primarily because, for the willow anyway, we had poor stock. It was much thicker diameter than it should have been cuttings. And for some of the willow that we planted, there was also some mold growing on the outside of the stacks. Whereas the miscanthus, it should have been okay. The variety does work here. It could have been that it wasn't planted as plugs like we had success with the second year. Initially it was done with rhizomes, and they did come up, but they did not survive the overwintering. I'm not sure why that happened.
There's a lesson learned here for anyone who's interested in growing a crop of trees or perennial grass to produce biomass.
Primarily, make sure you're getting good quality stock from a trusted source. It would be much better to, you know, pay a little more and know that your crop is going to come up and you're going to have a good establishment than, you know, maybe get older or stock from someone who's not used to making the cuttings or producing the rhizomes and have a failure, which you're going to have to pay for in terms of, well, you lost a year and you paid for stock that didn't do you anything.
John tried something different with the poplar. He didn't coppice the initial growth.
So I left it as a single stem for 3 years. And this is because a lot of people had coppicing issues with poplar, where it wouldn't coppice that strongly, and the following year after they did, it would be kind of a weaker growth. So what I did was I coppiced after its first three-year cycle, and it allowed the coppicing to be effective. So the year after coppice, it was very prolific and looked just like the willow did. So it was a learning experience, and some other people have done it, and this might be because poplar does have like a longer growing cycle where it reaches its, you know, maximum annual increment. So kind of getting it close to that, letting it ramp up a bit and develop its root system may allow it to produce a much better a coppicing event where you have multiple stems afterwards.
The test plots needed a lot of manual weeding. There are no registered herbicides available yet, so weed control is a major issue. That's especially true with herbaceous crops because the weeds are also herbaceous. Weed control can be very challenging on a commercial scale.
Naresh Thevathasan is the manager of agroforestry research and development at the University of Guelph. He says climate change is having an impact on insects and diseases.
We are observing pests and diseases that normally do not occur due to warming up of atmospheric temperature. So we are also faced with a similar risk associated with growing this biomass. Especially with willow and poplar, they are hybrids, so they are genetically identical plant material. So if we get a pest or disease outbreak, we could run the risk of losing the entire plantation. So therefore, more research is needed in this area where we have to evaluate the pest and disease outbreak on these biomass crops and what control strategies that we could develop.
The land wasn't fertilized until this year, the crop's third year. For comparison, the researchers fertilized only one half of a plot and not the other.
So as you can see, we split fertilized this plot, and on my right here, you can see the color is a little lighter and also the height of the miscanthus is a little shorter as compared to my left, where they're a little bit darker green and they're also a little bit higher. We did minimal fertilization. We didn't do a lot because you can boost their yield with a lot of fertilization, but at the same time, that's extra cost and extra impact to the environment in terms of your greenhouse gases that you're, you know, using to make your inorganic fertilizers.
Herbaceous crops are harvested every year once they're established. A simple weed whacker is used to harvest miscanthus here at this University of Guelph test plot. A sickle bar mower could also be used for small plots. Large harvesters could be used on a commercial scale. Specialized balers called bio balers are used to harvest willow and poplar crops. After the first year of growth, the trees are cut down, leaving stumps in the ground. New stems coppice from the stumps, and 3 years later, the trees are ready to be harvested.
So which biomass crop performed best in this three-year establishment phase?
I wouldn't say any one is better than the other, especially since the yields are kind of similar over the 3-year term. So we found that even with no fertilization, willow, poplar, miscanthus, and even the native grasses like switchgrass and the polyculture did just fine.
It's clear that all of the woody and herbaceous species are capable of growing on marginal land with minimal inputs.
But we'd like to see what they'll do once they're fully established and mature. So further research needs to be done on this site and many others, comparing all the different species and how they'll perform once they're producing the marketable yields that, you know, you want to see out of these crops.
Burning biomass releases carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, so you might think that it's harmful to the environment.
However, only a part of the carbon dioxide that this willow has absorbed is released back into the atmosphere. The remaining part of the carbon dioxide is stored in the below ground components of these plants, in the roots and in the soils. So we only emit a part that we have already absorbed from the atmosphere back into the atmosphere during the burning process. So there's no net emission of carbon dioxide. When you compare it with coal, we take coal from deep in the ground and we emit into the atmosphere. So there's always a net emission. And also, in order to assess the quality of the biomass, the fuel quality of the biomass, we send samples from these biomass sources to a facility, a test facility in Sarnia. Their name is Senatec, and they assess for ash and the mineral components in the ash. This way we will know what is the best source of biomass. Is it willow better than miscanthus, or is it miscanthus better than switchgrass? So this type of analysis we are doing in order to rank the biomass for its fuel quality.
Fuel quality is an important part of the comparative analysis. For example, burning biomass leaves ash that can cause problems in boilers. So which had the most ash, woody or herbaceous biomass?
The herbaceous species typically have a higher ash content. Miscanthus did better in terms of ash content than the switchgrass or the polyculture, but was still higher than the willow or the poplar. And not by much, but a few percent.
Residual ash can create clinker, which can coat the inside of boilers. The more brittle the clinker, the better. If it's glass-like, it's harder to remove.
The woody species produce a slightly more brittle clinker than the herbaceous species. It's typically more glass-like when you have a lot of silica in your ash content, which is typical of herbaceous species.
Burning the various biomass crops in a test facility revealed the composition of the ash. But it's still unclear how each of the species will perform in a large furnace or boiler.
Combustion is a very dynamic process, and different minerals within the ash will react with each other and cause different problems based on their ratios and how much of each thing is there. So just looking at the ash content, while useful, and you know, you can get an estimate of what might happen, we don't really know what will happen. So yes, more research needs to be done in that area.
John Mann's thesis really provided us with a lot of useful information on the early establishment and development of certain herbaceous and woody biomass crops, but it's important to understand that these studies were undertaken in the establishment phase, and we need to continue the research into some stands that are older and possibly under different fertilization regimes. That will really cap up a unique study.
Ultimately, we're going to have to develop a suite of biomass options, species, different residue types, varieties within species. Even within miscanthus or willow or poplar, you're not going to have one variety that is the be-all and end-all. Even within those, you're going to have to develop suitable varieties to match the location and environments.
Dr. Thethathasan says more research is needed to show that producing and burning biomass is carbon neutral. A life cycle analysis will document greenhouse gas emissions every step of the way, from planting to burning.
I am pleased to say that Ontario Minister of Agriculture and Food is funding a life cycle analysis work in relation to willow production. So we are almost end of that project, and once the report is out, we will know how environmentally friendly growing willow biomass to derive bioenergy.
The Ontario government is providing two avenues of support for biomass research.
Ontario Ministry of Agriculture and Food and Ministry of Rural Affairs support biomass research and innovation through new directions and annual funding programs through a partnership with the University of Guelph.
For more information about biomass research, visit the Ontario Ministry of Agriculture and Food website or contact the Agroforestry Research and Development Group at the University of Guelph.